I love how God times things and the way he puts together things. I love how he plans certain messages in ways that I couldn't have creatively planned myself. So on a day that we're celebrating the veterans who have served our country, and really, I should probably say, we probably should be remembering veterans all around the world, shouldn't we?
Yeah.
I mean, all around the world, and soldiers that are in active duty as well. But on a day that we're talking about war and fighting and battles, guess what God told us to pray about, to preach about today? Deliver us from evil. Deliver us from the evil one. The spiritual battle that we're all a part of. Whether you put on your armor or not, you're in a battle. Whether you think that you can stand up against evil or not, you're in a fight. You're a soldier. Now, I realize, and I should just probably give this caveat. My childhood upbringing is the Mennonite Church. Anybody know anything about the Mennonite Church? Well, the Mennonite Church, I come from the Old Order Mennonite Church. Okay, that means we were next to the Amish. Okay, in fact, my aunt was Amish, all right? So, and the Old Order Mennonite really believe in a simple lifestyle, but they also believe in not killing another person. They have a historic peace stance, a recognized one by our own government. So you, if you are Mennonite and share your faith, you are actually allowed to be 1AO, conscientious objector to war. I would rather not take someone's life. And I would, in fact, rather probably, while emotionally I wouldn't like it, have my life be taken than somebody else's life be taken. And Jesus says we're supposed to do what? See, I hear verses, and I grew up understanding this. You're supposed to what, your enemies? Oh, no, go out and shoot them, blow them away, right? I mean, come on. That's what we need. We need our military to understand that, don't we? Kind of a hard thing if you tell the soldier, okay, go out there on the field, drop your guns, and love them. Although throughout history, there have been amazing, amazing moments when that has happened. Like in World War I, was it when the soldiers out on Christmas Eve, a German soldier stood up on a battlefield and he started to sing, Stille Nacht, Heilige Nacht. And on the other side, they started joining in, All is calm, all is bright. And soldiers from Germany and America who were on a battlefield killing one another met in the middle of that battlefield. Because there's Christians on both sides, right? Sometimes. And in this case, there were. And they met on that battlefield and worshiped Jesus. Yeah, of course, it wasn't long after that the shooting started again. But it was a holy kind of a moment. We have tools and weapons to do battle that will destroy and break evil. Our greatest weapon that caused Satan to be defeated was Christ hanging on the cross. Submitting himself to his Father, dying on that cross, and paying the price of sin. And when Satan thought he was having his greatest victory, he was actually having his final defeat. Now, we're still in a world that the Antichrist is still at work, the spirit of the Antichrist is still present, Satan's still doing things, but the fact is that he's already been defeated. And he's in those days, kind of like post D-Day, where, okay, he's trying to do things and he wants to take as many people down with him as he can. I don't understand that. I mean, I do not comprehend how an angel that was in the presence of God and a third of the host of heaven could be cast out with him because they didn't love God enough, worship God. having been there, that they would leave and that they would move totally to this sense of dark side and be opposed and the kinds of things that are part of evil. I don't understand. Our text for this morning is 1 John chapter 4. I want to challenge us to consider weapons that are more powerful than guns, more powerful than bombs. Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. But every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now, all is already in the world. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. They are from the world and therefore speak from the viewpoint of the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God, and whoever knows God listens to us. But whoever is not from God does not listen to us. This is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood. Incidentally, just a short comment there. This is John, the beloved. John, the writer of Revelation. John, the one who was sitting next to Jesus, or lying, as we would actually say, lying on the floor there next to Jesus as he's dipping in the bread. And John's the one saying, Jesus, who is the one who's going to betray you? And Jesus says, it's the one with whom I'm going to dip this bread. And he'll take and dip the bread and hand it to Judas. John's the one that's right there in the ear of Jesus. He's on the right side. He's the loving servant. He's the one who's closest to Jesus of all the disciples. He's in that inner circle of Peter, James, and John. This is that John. John is the one who will see him risen from the dead. He'll be the last of the disciples who will die. He'll die on the island of Patmos. He doesn't die a death like the others. Everyone else dies in crucifixion, stonings, burnings, all kinds of things like that. But John dies out on this island, separated from everybody, and yet there God meets him, gives him revelation, tells him about what's going to happen at the end of time. This is that John. It's a pretty important John. And when he's talking about being listened to, he's saying, listen to us, the disciples who were there. We walked with Jesus. We saw the miracles. We experienced them. We were there when we saw him crucified. We were there when we saw him risen from the dead. We were there. This is that John. And he's saying, because we were firsthand witnesses of Jesus, listen to us. You see, he's not saying because I'm this great Jew or because I'm this great scholar. He's saying, we were firsthand in his presence. And so don't discount the experiences that we had, because that's what we're going to share with you. The interesting thing about God is that he doesn't keep things secret. God reveals spiritual things and spiritual forces to people, if we'll listen. Even in the Old Testament, there is information about spiritual forces. In fact, do you remember what he said in Deuteronomy chapter 13, verses 1 to 5? He talks about a dreamer. And he says, if there's somebody who has dreams, in fact, let me read it for you. If a prophet or one who foretells by dreams appears among you and announces to you a sign or wonder, and if that sign or wonder spoken of takes place, and the prophet says, let us follow other gods. Uh-oh, that's not a good thing. Gods you have not known, and let us worship them. You must not listen to the words of that prophet or dreamer. The Lord your God is testing you to find out whether you love him with all your heart and with all your soul. It is the Lord your God you must follow, and him you must revere. Keep his commandments and obey him, serve him and hold fast to him. That prophet or dreamer must be put to death. for inciting rebellion against the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt and redeemed you from the land of slavery. That prophet or dreamer tried to turn you from the way of the Lord your God commanded you to follow. You must purge the evil from among you. Whoa. Serious stuff. And incidentally, take note, he says, if a dreamer who actually sees a vision and the vision comes true, that's kind of weird, isn't it? We kind of think of those things that are not of God as kind of being counterfeit, not real. But look, evil can give dreams and visions to people who are not following God, and those visions can be real and come true. And there is historical evidence of that. 1 Corinthians 12:10 talks about the ability to discern spirits. Okay, now I think I can finally give you my, my personal comment. I'm supposed to be an expert. Yeah, I did a doctorate on spiritual warfare, so I'm supposed to be an expert. All that means is I'm one of the most recent people that read and wrote, all right? An expert? I don't know about that. I do know that we had to learn a lot in this church. A lot about spiritual things and spiritual forces. There was a dark cloud. How many of you have been here for more than a year? Show of hands. Okay. How many of you have been here for less than a year? Or you're a guest with us? Yeah. Yeah. Sorry, you guys, or praise God, you didn't see some of what we saw and felt. Spiritual forces, there were those who recognized dark cloud inside here. I remember my friend who would stand outside the door and he'd pray that the people would leave their demons outside and then be able to come in and worship. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 says, "Now to each one the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit. To another gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another miraculous powers. To another prophecy. To another distinguishing between spirits." Remember that phrase. "To some, this ability is given to distinguish between spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And to still another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit. And he distributes them to each one just as he determines." A similar passage to this, where Paul, by the way, this is 1 Corinthians 12, right? 1 Corinthians 12, 13, 14, they're a really important set of verses together. Chapter 12, he's talking about spiritual gifts. Chapter 14, he's talking about spiritual gifts. And what does he put right in the middle, sandwiched in there as the meat in between the two pieces of bread? Love. The whole love chapter. "And whatever you do has to be done out of love." 1 John, which also is an incredible book, that talks about God's love. It's one where it says God is love. In chapter 3, verses 21 to 24, John says, "Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask because we keep his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. The one who keeps God's commands lives in him and he in them. And this is how we know he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us." There's a whole school of theology that says that the Holy Spirit stopped giving out these gifts that I read to you in 1 Corinthians 12. That the miracles and those kinds of things all ended once the canon, once the scripture was complete. My Bible's getting old. And once this was complete, that then we didn't need the Holy Spirit to do miraculous things like that. And so they all stopped. And That could be true. I would simply ask anyone who has that theology, please show me the verses. Please show me the verses that say the Holy Spirit stopped giving the Holy Spirit's gifts, because I don't think you'll find them. Now, you are welcome to your opinion on that. And I had a conversation with Wendy this week, and I just want to remind you what opinions are. Opinion is wisdom from God. I want wisdom from God. I want for you to have wisdom from God. When we're ever we're together, when we're out there serving Jesus, I want us to have God's wisdom, not our own. And a lot of us operate from our own instead of God's wisdom. A lot of us have opinions. And a lot of us share those opinions with other people. What is an opinion? An opinion is an opinion. Opinion, wisdom from God. Oh, no, he wants to hold her. By the way, Jasmine's in the house. And if she makes noise, it's okay, right?
Yes.
Okay, good. So, welcome. What is an opinion? Not wisdom from God, just telling you. You might want to watch it the next time you're sharing your opinions. The Word of God says that the Holy Spirit empowers us and gives us the ability to recognize spiritual forces. That's that phrase there when it says you'll be able to discern spirits. In our text, John is saying you need to test the spirits. You need to be aware of the spiritual forces and recognize those that are of Christ and those that are not of Christ. We have to discern that in our world and in our community. And frankly, I think it would be helpful for us to make use of that spiritual gift and allow the Holy Spirit to anoint and fill and overflow in our lives so we can do the things we need to do to set people free in this community. And I'd rather do it with the Holy Spirit that's described in Acts than the one that's described that says he doesn't give that power anymore. But you can follow your opinion on that. The early church was very conscious of spiritual powers. And this is one of the things that that theologians are saying as well. The early church had spiritual power because they were in a very pagan kind of a culture. Well, kind of like a lot of our world is today, in which there are all kinds of gods. And in fact, some of the people that I read about spiritual warfare said that, look, you just need to realize that if you're in a society where you believe that a tree might be a spirit, so you pray to it. Or the sun might be a spirit or a god, so you pray to it. And nature is somehow a force, and so you pray to it. If you're in that kind of a culture, and they actually do things like use witch doctors and stuff like that, well, of course, then there is evil. But for those of you who are enlightened, and you're in a culture who doesn't believe in that stuff, see, you don't have it to deal with. So congratulations. You're in an enlightened culture in America. So therefore, you don't have to battle with spiritual forces. You don't have to deal with demons because they're not here. They're simply symbols. They're simply things that people, you know, imagine. It's just a cultural kind of dynamic. Really? You're welcome to your opinion. The early church was conscious of spiritual powers. When the apostles came down to Samaria after the preaching of Philip and confirmed the gift of the Spirit on the new converts, the effects were so startling that the local magician, Simon Magus, remember this, wished to buy the power to produce those same spirits. They saw people being healed. They believed in ecstatic experiences of the power of the Holy Spirit. In fact, here's an interesting one. In the 3rd century, a gentleman named Montanus burst upon the church with the claim that he was nothing less than the promised paraclete. I'm the Holy Spirit, oh Lord. And then he proposed to tell the church the things which Christ had said his apostles could not at the moment bear. He had new information that he was going to give to them. Barclay, in talking about John's recognition is the Holy Spirit. He says, all this is in John's mind. This is a positive thing, by the way. And it is in face of that surging atmosphere of pulsating spiritual life that he sets out his criteria to judge between the true and the false. We, for our part, may well feel that with all its perils, the exuberant vitality of the early church was a far better thing than the apathetic placidity of so much of the life of the modern church. It was surely better that men should expect the Spirit everywhere than that they should expect him nowhere. John goes on and uses a very strong word. He says, test it. And you should do that, by the way. And folks, I sure hope you don't just come here and say, whatever Bill says is right. Yeah, I know some of you don't. Just don't tell me while I'm preaching unless I'm really screwed up, okay? Then get me out of here. But look at this. John says, test it. And every time you hear somebody speaking something spiritual, test it. Is it truth? And what's your measurement? The Word of God. Test it against what God has given to us, what he has communicated to us. Be careful. Don't test against what we say about it. Okay? And I know, obviously, I read the theologians, I read the commentaries, I look at all kinds of stuff as I'm researching and stuff like that. However, the truth that I want to look at is what's found in this book, not just what people are saying about the book. Don't depend upon just what I say on a Sunday morning to be your spiritual nourishment. Because I could be way wrong. And who knows? I might be giving opinions. So therefore, read the opinions. Test it. And it's an interesting phrase that's in our text that keeps coming up. He says, John says, test the spirits to see whether they are of God. Of God. In verse 2, every spirit which confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. Verse 3, every spirit which does not confess Jesus Christ is not of God. Verse 4, little children, you are of God. Verse 6, we are of God. He who is not of God does not listen to us. What does it mean to be of God? To be ektotheos. It means to belong to God, to be from God, to be God's children. I believe it was Barclay who said the simplest translation of God. But what does is from God. But what does from mean in that phrase, he asked. Quite certainly it means that the person, the spirit, or the quality has its origin in God. It comes from God in the sense that it takes its origin in him and its life from him. So John, for instance, bids his people to test the spirits to see whether they really have their source in God. Love, he says in 1 John, has its origin where? In God. So he says, test the spirits. 1 Corinthians 12:3 says, therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed. And no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. 2 John 1:7. I say this because many deceivers who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh have gone out into the world. Any such person is the deceiver and the Antichrist. Yes, the Antichrist already present back in the early days of the church. Revelation. Whoa, this is one you may want to look at. Chapter 16. Revelation 16, verses 13 and 14. Then I saw three impure spirits that looked like frogs. They came out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. They are demonic spirits that perform signs, and they go out to the kings of the whole world to gather them for the battle on the great day of God Almighty. That's actually Armageddon. 1 Thessalonians tells us this, and this is a section of scripture you may want to memorize. You know, we say that the shortest verse in the Bible is Jesus wept. Well, maybe the second shortest verse is 1 Thessalonians 5:16, rejoice always. Or verse 17, pray continually. Father God, right now, you know whatever crisis is taking place. You know who is traveling to that event. And Lord, I pray your protection upon those who are going to serve and for those who are in need. Whatever it is, God, show them your love. Minister peace and comfort. Give these responders the ability to see the need and meet it. And Jesus, put somebody there who can show your love to all those involved. In Jesus' name, amen. Paul goes on, he says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit, do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all, hold to what is good, reject every kind of evil. How do you know what's evil? You got to test it. You have to examine it. And here's the test that John said to use. Confess Jesus in the flesh. John MacArthur is one of the theologians who believes that a lot of the spiritual things that the Holy Spirit did kind of ended centuries ago. But it's interesting to read an article that he talked about when he talks about this word testing. This is from This is from his commentary where he was talking. He says, the word for testing is dokimazo, a technical term for testing persons for a very high office. You test them, and it's present tense, continually be testing. The believer must have in his life the continuing practice of the testing of spirits. Interesting. He actually goes on, he says, now please, this does not refer to talking to demons. And folks, I've found that when you're going to deal with demonic forces, I would strongly urge you, don't converse with them. There are a number of people who do exorcisms and cast out demons, and some of you may have heard stories of experiences like this where they've gone on for hours and hours, and somebody's almost getting beat up in the process, and they're talking to the demon, and demons telling them all kinds of stuff. Folks, if the demons follow the father of lies, who is Satan, what are they going to tell you? I'm just thinking that if you're going to listen to a demon, you might be listening to somebody who's going to be lying. Therefore, when I've dealt with demonic forces in people, I don't talk to the demons, I talk to the people. Now, here's an interesting thing that John MacArthur said. He said, now please, this does not just refer to talking to demons. If a guy comes along and says such and such, it isn't the idea that you say, all right now, I don't want to talk to you. Hey, you demon in there, now I want to say something to you. Question number one on the test. Is Jesus in the flesh? You know, now it isn't only a dialogue with demon, it's a dialogue with the mouthpiece of the demon or the demon. He says, I talked to a demon in the occasion where I was involved in a situation he was describing with a man. I don't even like to talk about it because people think I've lost my marbles. But it occurred some years back. And I know that there and they know who I am because they told me. And I'm glad they know who I am because I bug them and that's good. He's actually describing his experience where he was conversing with a demon and the demon was telling him that they didn't like him and why they didn't like him and they were upset with him and all. He says, but I don't recommend that you spend time talking to demons. Did you see the event that just took place this last week at the Vatican? It's reported in Religion Today. Pope Francis blessed 300 exorcists this past week. The International Association of Exorcists says Satanism is gaining popularity. Walter Cascioli, and Kevin, Kenny, I don't know if I'm saying that right or not, but neither do you, right? This gentleman, a spokesman for the organization, said there has been an extraordinary increase in demonic activity. And he shared that on Vatican Radio just this last week. The Bible warns us against false doctrine. Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 9 passionately exhorts the Israelites to serve Jehovah and not forget the things he's taught them. Throughout Scripture, we are warned. Jesus in Matthew 24 predicts that there would become false prophets and false Christs. Whoa. People declaring themselves to be Christ, the anointed one, the Messiah. The Apostle Paul cautioned the Ephesian elders that grievous wolves would enter in, not sparing the flock. Perverse things would be what they speak. 2 Peter warns about apostates who will come and teach false doctrine. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1, the Spirit clearly says that in later times some will abandon faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. John MacArthur, again, speaking on 1 Timothy, says emphatically, 1 Timothy emphatically links false doctrine with demonism as the source. False teachers and false prophets are not primarily to blame. Interesting thought. False teachers and false prophets are not primarily to blame. They are to blame. They are not primarily to blame. In other words, yes, they have blame, but they're not the primary. They're secondary to blame. Primarily, the blame goes to the demon who is invisible. That demon spirit who is the false teacher, and the man is only the mouthpiece. Remember that the next time you hear somebody propagating something that's contrary to the Scripture, that's a demon. Now, the manifestation may come in a bizarre way or it may come in a very obvious way, but it's a demon. This is John MacArthur speaking. 1 John chapter 2, verses 20 to 23. But you have anointing from the Holy One. Thank you, Jesus. And all of you know the truth. I do not write to you because you do not know the truth, but because you do know it, and because no lie comes from the truth. Who is the liar? It is whoever denies that Jesus is the Christ. Such a person is the Antichrist. Denying the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever acknowledges the Son has the Father also. I would encourage you to read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 this week. For there, Paul says, watch out for the Antichrist. And the details are given of how he's going to be exposed, and he's going to show himself in the temple of God. And incidentally, folks, while many of us have thought that the temple would be rebuilt and that would be the thing that we will know, and therefore once the temple is rebuilt, it may not actually happen. But the Antichrist will still show himself where? At the place of the temple. And there may be actually things built there, and in fact, there are already things that are happening on the temple site, folks. And the whole Antichrist will show himself right there at the Temple Mount. And he talks about this as Paul continues to describe what's going to happen with the Antichrist. Folks, we have a lot of non-truths being communicated to our culture. I might step on somebody's toes, but Oprah Winfrey has said, every morning I watch the sun come up and I center myself and try to touch the God light that I believe is in all of us. I just call it centering up. If there happens to be a day when I don't do it, I find myself loose and misdirected. The way of the cross, the way of Lao Tzu, the way of Buddha, the way of Islam, and the way of Judaism all speak of the same path. All refer to the same transformation of self. That's Marcus Borg. Shirley MacLaine says, God lies within, and therefore we are each part of God. Since there is no separateness, we are each God-like, and God is in each of us. We are literally made up of God energy. Therefore, we can create whatever we want in life because we are each co-creating with the energy of God, the energy that makes the universe itself. Are you testing this? She goes on, she says, I know that I exist, therefore, and watch out with this one. I know that I exist, therefore I am. I know that the God source exists, therefore it is. Since I am part of that force, then I am that I am. Is evil present in our world today and want us to believe its lies? Well, here's the good news. Greater is the one in you than the one who is in the world. Walter Wink said, we moderns cannot bring ourselves by any feat of will or imagination to believe in the real existence of these mythological entities that traditionally have been lumped under the general category principalities and powers. We naturally assume that the ancients conceived of them and believed in them the same way we conceive of and disbelieve them. We think they thought of the powers quite literally as a variety of invisible demonic beings flapping around in the sky, occasionally targeting some luckless mortal with their malignant payload of disease, lust, possession, or death. We play a double trick on ourselves, first personifying spiritual entities that are in fact not persons, and then dismissing the creations of our own personifying as improbable, non-empirical, unscientific, superstitious. Postmodern thinking and our ignorance in this area have probably hindered us from doing the will of God in our community, folks. A great tool of evil is to talk people into disbelieving in the reality of principalities and powers. How can anyone have victory over something they believe does not exist? C.S. Lewis warns us of the two great dangers, either overbelieving or not believing, and both are going to cause a problem. I want to read just a quote from the Mellinger thesis. I have seen people set free when Jesus came into their lives. I've prayed for victory for the oppressed. I have not dialogued with a demon, but I have used the authority of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit to cast out demons. This thesis is built on a theological tradition that believes in the authority of the Word of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, and the truth that Jesus has authority over the enemy, 1 John 4:4. That, incidentally, was the phrase that was blocked out the night that I was working on my thesis. And all of a sudden, as I'm working from one window to the other, on this window over here, I'm reading my thesis. And on this window over here, I'm marking stuff for my professor to let him know what I've changed. So all my markings going on this window. This window over here is just a little bit ahead, about a half a paragraph ahead. And I look to this window, and all of a sudden I see over here the wonderful number 666. And at first I'm perturbed. Just kind of bugged, like, how did that get there? And then all of a sudden I'm like, oh no, what did I just lose? Because, you know, if you have something like that that's over, in other words, I've probably somehow bumped 666 several times. I may have just lost 3 pages of my thesis. I don't know. So, but wisdom sets in, and I hit the restore button. You know that button that can go backwards to whatever was before it? And underneath where 666 was on my paper was the phrase, the truth that Jesus has authority over the enemy, 1 John 4:4. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Folks, we don't need to be afraid of evil. But we do need to believe that Jesus came in the flesh, died on a cross, rose from the dead, and has given us his Holy Spirit to have victory. Well, some of you are hoping I hurry up and get done. May I make a few points? Satan cannot lead you into sin unless you give in. Satan cannot deceive you unless you choose to reject the truth. Satan cannot take up residence unless you give him a foothold. So how do you discern it? How do you recognize spiritual forces? How do you know what you're dealing with? How do you test the spirits? Well, number one, I would say pray. Oh, this is a series on prayer, isn't it? Our best weapon we have to do spiritual battle, to understand, God, show me, is this the enemy? Is this truth? Is this from you or not? And guess what God will do? Answer. Talk to Daryl Davis and ask him to share the story that he shared, probably here at church. I don't remember if he did or not, but I had him share it at the Transformation Ministries conference. About when we asked the board, and we were going through a lot of stuff here, and there was a sense of spiritual darkness in this place, and there was conflict in the worship, and just negative things that were happening. And ask him, when I said, okay, board members, I'm going to pray a prayer for you, and you're probably not going to like it if God answers the prayer. And the prayer was, God, please give one or all the members of this board the spiritual gift of discerning spirits. And the reason why I warned them that they weren't going to be happy if God answered that prayer was because I said, you're going to see things you don't want to see. We live in a world where if we don't see the spiritual forces, we don't have to deal with them, right? The ugliness of seeing what they look like. But Daryl will tell you about the experience he had when the man was raging and he left the building. And just before he left, he turned to make some more comments back to the leadership team and their wives. And Daryl will tell you about the demonic being that he saw. And there are others who can talk about the blackness that they saw coming out of this room, who can talk about the demonic forces that they've saw in things. But there's a new joy here. Are any of you sensing it? There's a new confidence here because there's new commitment. There are spiritual forces that have been attacked. And guess how we did it? With the weapons that Jesus has given to us. And so we started by blessing and forgiving and confessing and loving and praying. How do you develop discernment? Pray. Listen contextually. Listen with an ear to what is being said. And you, again, please do this when I'm preaching. Listen to what I'm saying with one ear on what I'm saying and one ear on the Word of God. Listen to the context of what the Word of God says. Don't just look at a little phrase I grab out and say, oh, is that the message? No, no. You make sure that you see what that verse means, what that phrase means in the context where it was written, in the people it was spoken to. See what the Word of God says. And then examine the Scriptures. And God will show you what is of Him and what is not. Confess Jesus is the Christ in the flesh. I'm going to quote from John MacArthur one more time. He says, I'm going to close by just let's apply the test. Okay, just for fun in closing, number one, confess the divine Lord. For example, Christian Science. Christian Science says this, Jesus was a human man who demonstrated the Christ spirit, which is ideal truth. It doesn't line up with the test, does it? So each time, here's what MacArthur's going to say. This is demonic. Jehovah's Witnesses. They say, Jesus is a created person, created by Jehovah, the second greatest person, born as a man, and became the Messiah in 29 A.D., at the end of his life. quoting MacArthur, out, that's right, out of the pit. Theosophy, the theosophy says, Jesus is a man who taught good ideas. More demons. Here's one that's local. Mormonism. Mormonism teaches that Jesus is one of many sub-gods to the one true God. The Unitarian Church teaches Jesus is not the Christ, there isn't a Trinity. And modernism teaches Jesus was a great ethical teacher, and that is just as demonic as all the rest. Father God, please block out anything that's not been of you that's going to hinder anyone from testing and seeing and believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the living God, the Messiah who came in human form, the Word that dwelt among us full of grace and truth, that died on a cross and rose from the dead, the truly the anointed one who takes away the sins of the world. Help us to see and believe and to confess that this day. In Jesus' name, amen.